left high school and moved into the city of Houston and started attending the University of Houston. I was a chemistry major and did pretty well, but again, no money. The money wasn't there. And then started to work. Of course, I had a part-time job, but the mistake I made was in the age of student deferments of dropping to half-time, you know, to work a little bit more. And from that point, I was drafted.
Clarence Sasser was drafted into the Army in 1967 at the age of 19. After a series of tests, he was sent for training as a medical aid man.
We like to call ourselves combat medics. Although a lot of medics weren't sent into combat, I always knew I would. It's one of those things you just know.
On the morning of January 10th, 1968, Clarence Sasser would experience his first heavy combat. The battalion commander sent his company on a reconnaissance mission toward the Mekong Delta to investigate reports of enemy activity.
You know, I was on probably the third, fourth helicopter. We go in and the helicopters start taking fire, rockets. A thoroughly bad situation. One of the helicopters got hit and plumped down in the water. We got off the helicopter. I got grazed getting off the helicopter in the leg. Fire all around us. With the helicopter down, there wasn't any choice. We had to go in. And so we were dumped in the rice paddock. The mortars were coming in, snipers were around. Guys were yelling, "Doc, Doc." And of course, at this point, there's no semblance of platoon-like unity.
During the first 30 minutes, over 30 casualties were sustained. Without hesitation, Sasser ran across an open rice paddy, threw a hail of fire to assist the wounded. After helping one man to safety, he was painfully struck by incoming fire.
I was almost hit with a mortar round that almost just totally sprayed my back. Shell fragments are something I'll never forget how they feel. Man, you could hear them all day, boy. They come in, boom, and then you hear where they're just shooting into the water, and when it hit the water, you hear it just sizzle, man. I had learned early on that the best way to get around that day was just simply grabbing the rice sprouts and sliding yourself along. You could move better like that than to try to, of course, stand up. If you stood up, you were dead. Especially they see your bag, they know you're a medic. You know, you kill a medic, a lot of people probably would die. It was the rationale.
Despite two additional wounds from machine gun fire that immobilized his legs, Sasser refused medical attention and continued to search for the wounded, administering critically needed support.
My job was to care for the guys, maybe get them to carry on. And in fact, what I remember telling one guy was, "Your man, take your weapon after I finished putting the bandage on. Take your weapon, let's try to get out of here." And we went in probably 10, 10:15 that morning. We spent the whole day in the rice paddy. Terrible people getting killed. We spent the night being looked over by the Phantom Air Force, Phantom pilots were dropping napalm in the tree line. Essentially kept them off of us all night or we all would have died. We laid there that night. All you could hear was guys moaning, calling for their mama. "Help me. There's nothing I can do." They got us out, I guess about four o'clock that morning. They tested and came into the area and with the chopper. Well, it was a relief. It was a relief we were out of there and I was still alive. I was hurt, but I wasn't in mortal danger. I was hurt. I knew me. I knew I would heal and I would heal fairly quickly. After I had recovered and the understanding doctor had gotten me reassigned, I don't know what he did or how he pulled strings, but they did need medics there. I was called into his office. He was, of course, the officer in charge of the dispensary and told me that the Department of Defense had decided to award me a Medal of Honor. It was really an experience from my background, of course, you know, poor farm family and every day. My mother and sisters were flown up to D.C. And of course, the best thing that ever happened to them. We enjoyed it, tremendously enjoyed it. It's confirmation to me that I did my job. And that's how I had to deal with it, because what's my job? I don't think what I did was above and beyond. I never have. And I don't make a point of it, but you know, being one of the only two black guys alive now, I think it means a lot to the country that I am who I am.